Mosaic.
Hello.
Hey, why don't we stand and have a word of prayer together? Let's go before the Lord. Jesus, thank you for bringing us together here today. Lord, I thank you that you woke us up this morning in your grace and your mercy anew. And I just pray, Lord, that we would rejoice in you and in the work you accomplished on the cross, Lord. And Lord, that you've made a way, you've paid a price for us to come before you to your throne of grace boldly and worship you, sing of you, learn from you, speak to you, hear from you, Lord. And I pray that today we would be able to meet with you in a special way. And Lord, that we would not leave this place without being changed, Lord. And that we would be able to take what we've learned today and what we've experienced today together into our personal lives, into our homes, Lord, our workplaces. So, Lord, I just pray your Holy Spirit would speak to our hearts and that you would do a work that only you can do. Thank you, God, for always being concerned for our good, Lord, as we are looking to give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. my heart, oh, take and seal it, seal it for thy courts above.
Again, 'cause I lay me down, I'm not mine.
Still waters. Lord, bring us peace. Lord, we turn to you. We look to you, God, the only Savior.
You high. Father, we're desperate for you. We long to meet with you, Lord. We don't come here out of ritual routine, Lord. We come out of desperation. Lord, we want to meet with you, God. We want to hear you speak to our hearts, Lord. Lord, we cry out not for something that we can do for ourselves or even for one another, Lord. We come from different places, Lord. Some of us are in the valley. Some of us are on the mountaintop. Some are hurting, Lord. Some are rejoicing. Lord, only you can meet each individual right where they're at, Lord. So I pray that's what you do through the power of your Holy Spirit, through the inspired word that you brought, Lord, just through the fellowship of the saints, Lord. Come join and meet with us here, Lord. May you be glorified and exalted, Lord. May your saints be edified and built up and strengthened and encouraged, all for your glory. It's in your mighty name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. All right, children can be released to their appropriate rooms. There's signage for that. In the meantime, please greet one another. Praise the Lord. Good morning, Mosaic. My name's Ken. I'm one of the guys around here. Tony's asked me to share, giving me the privilege, the honor. I pray that you're not like me, like when you come expecting one thing and something else is given to you, you're like, oh no, who's this guy? I'm gonna have to sit through this. You're gonna drink your coffee out of a styrofoam cup instead of your favorite mug, all right? That's what it's like. Still the same word, still the same spirit, still the same God. So give me a chance. Give me grace, please. We're going to be in 1 Kings 17. 1 Kings 17. We're going back in the books. We're going to talk about Elijah and the life of Elijah. And a lot of people get hesitant when we go into the Old Testament thinking, oh, this is going to be dry. This is going to be boring. How does this apply to me? But there's, it was written and put in scriptures. All scriptures God breathed. Useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness. It's all good. It's written for us to encourage us. It's written to us that there's something for us to learn from him, from his life. And we're just going to take a real small excerpt part of Elijah's life, and hopefully it'll encourage us, strengthen our faith, help us to rely and trust in him more, draw us closer to him. So we're going to be in 1 Kings 17. We're also, if you guys have a marker, if you could put a mark, go towards the front of from 1 Kings 17 to Deuteronomy 11. We're also going to be there. Deuteronomy 11, 1 Kings 17, and then just one passage in the back, in the book of James, chapter 5, verse 17. I'm going to be in those three places. That's all I'm going to ask you to turn to. The rest of them, you won't have to. We're going to start in 1 Kings 17. I'm going to pray first, and then we'll dive in. Father, I cry out in desperation, Lord. God, if it's just me up here talking, there's no power. It's just words. So, Lord, we just pray for your Holy Spirit to come and speak through your Spirit-inspired word to these people, Lord. I just pray you'd nourish them, you would strengthen them, Lord, that you would feed your lambs, you would feed your sheep, you would feed your stubborn ewe or ram, Lord. God, just take the same word and nourish your flock like only you can through the power of your Spirit. To all the praise and glory to you. In Jesus' name, amen. As Tony, you know, I'm just going to play Tony. No, we can't really start at 17. We're going to have to back up. First Kings 16, verse 29. We got to keep it in context, kind of tell you what's going on. Bear with me. This is kind of historical and it's kind of dry, but just don't let me lose you, all right? Just hang in there. 1 Kings 16, verse 29. In the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, Ahab, son of Omri, became king of Israel. So here you have two kings. You have a king of Judah and a king of Israel. The kingdom has been separated. If you go back to David, David said it will never be separated. As long as you worship me, you love me with all your heart, you'll always have the kingdom. He gave it to Solomon. Solomon built the temple. He was the wisest man in the world. But the wisest man in the world had 700 wives. So I really don't know how wise he was. And they led him, seriously, and they led him to worship false gods and idolatry. And then the kingdom was separated. And so that happened in like 930 BC is when the kingdom was separated. This present time, when Ahab is being anointed king, it's going to be like 860 BC. So we're talking like 70 years of kings, all right? 70 years of kings of Israel. In the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, Ahab, son of Omri, became king of Israel, so King Ahab. And he reigned in Samaria over Israel for 22 years. For 22 years he was king. Verse 30, Ahab, son of Omri, did more evil in the eyes of the Lord than any of those before him. And if you look back in the history, from the beginning of time, from the beginning when they started having kings, it was repeated over and over and over again. They tell you who the king is, and it says, the king did evil in the eyes of the Lord. The king did evil in the eyes of the Lord. King did evil in the eyes. They've all been evil kings in Israel. Judah had a few good ones. Israel never had a good one. They were all bad. They were all doing bad things. So he did worse than any, the worst king ever. Verse 31, he not only considered it trivial to commit the sins of Jeroboam, son of Nebat. Now, the sins of Jeroboam was instead of allowing his people to go to Jerusalem and worship in the temple and at the altar, he created two golden calves. And he put one in Bethel and one in Dan. He didn't like, oh, they don't have to travel so far. They can just come and offer sacrifices on these calves, these golden calves. It's idolatry. He introduced idolatry. Jeroboam did. And Ahab, he considered that trivial. Like, it's no big deal. No problem. It was only the beginning of what he was doing. He not only considered it trivial to commit the sins of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, but he also married Jezebel, daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians, and began to serve Baal and worship him. So now he's worshiping a false god. He's worshiping an idol, Baal. He was like a fertility god. They thought that he was the one that brought the rains. They thought he was the one that brought the fruit of the ground. They thought he was the one that brought the fruit of the womb. False god, worshiping him. Continues, it says, he began to worship him. In verse 32, it says, he set up an altar for Baal in the temple of Baal that he built in Samaria. So he's in the promised land, and he's building a temple for this false god and an altar, and there's offering sacrifices there to this fertility god, this guy that supposedly provides the rain and the fertile things of the soil and of the womb. Not only that, verse 33, Ahab also made an Asherah pole and did more to provoke the Lord of the God of Israel to anger than did all the other kings before him. He worshipped in this god of Asherah. It was symbolic of a pole, it's like a tree without branches. And they worshipped, and she was a fertility god as well. And so they're worshipping these false gods, these idols, and what was happening there in that context was just unbelievable. It's sick. They thought there was prostitutes and everything else that would come, and they would have sex on the altar because they thought by doing that was a worship for the god of multiplication, and they would have sex on the altar. There was male prostitutes, female prostitutes. It was debauchery. Not only that, they were sacrificing their children, mostly their firstborn, thinking as a sacrifice so that their wombs would continue to be fruitful and their land would continue to be fruitful. Dark, dark times. We think things are dark here. They've been dark for a long time. But even in the darkest times, God has never let his light snuff out, ever. You look back all the way back, he always raised up a man. Noah, when there was one man. There was Noah. There was Moses. There's been prophet after prophet after prophet after prophet. The light of truth will never be snuffed out, ever. Even though it's dark, even though you might not see it, it will never be totally snuffed out. God promises that. Be encouraged in that. Even though we might not see it, God's still good. So that's what was going on at this point in time. Just debauchery. Horrible stuff happening. So that's going to lead us to Elijah, the prophet. He's going to be the one that God's going to raise up right now to be a shining light. Now let's see what we can learn about Elijah. Verse 1, chapter 17, 1 Kings. Now Elijah, the Tishbite from Tishba in Gilead. Now that's a lot of background. It doesn't say anything about him. It doesn't give him where he came from. It doesn't tell who his parents are. It doesn't say how old he is. It doesn't say anything about him. It just tells me that he's a Tishbite from Tishba in Gilead. So I look up Tishba. I'm like, I'm doing some study. Where was Tishba? What happened in Tishba? What was the definition of Tishba was? The place where Elijah resided. That's what Tishba is known for. I'm like, that was really informative. I'm glad I spent the time to investigate that. It was just a small little town. It's no significance. He comes from nowhere. He has no genealogy. He hasn't born into the right tribe. You don't even know for sure which tribe. Manasseh or Gad, because it was from Gilead. That was split between those two tribes. But we still don't know for sure. Gilead was a mountainous desert range. I mean, it was mountainous. It was rough country. It's east of the Jordan. It's where Jordan is right now, in current day Jordan. Very mountainous. It had valleys and some water running through it. But I mean, the wolves and everything in the valleys were bad. It was rough territory. It was rugged. It would be isolation. You were either a farmer in the valley or you would raise sheep. And he was probably a rugged guy. Used to being alone, strong. I like to think of a guy like that. I can relate to someone like that. Just a rugged, rough dude. Just a normal guy. And most of the time when God raised up a prophet or God raised someone up, it was just a normal person. It wasn't some great lineage. It was he just chose a man by his heart. Man looks at the outward. God looks at the heart. So we don't know a lot about him other than he was a Tishbite in Tishba and he was from Gilead. But if you look into chapter 19, I think it was, 1910, it says that he was very zealous for the Lord Almighty. We know that he was passionate for God. We know that he was a man that loved the Lord. He loved Jehovah. He was zealous for him. So if he's zealous for him and he sees what's going on or hears what's going on in the promised land, he's obviously going to be disgraced. He's going to be disgruntled. He's going to be angry. He's going to be deeply grieved, brokenhearted. If you love the Lord and you see that the glory of God is being defaced and defiled, it should move in your heart. It moved in my heart to say, like, is my heart broken for the disgrace that I see that our world is, how the glory of God is being defamed and disgraced, and does it break my heart? What do you do? What did he do? Let's turn back to James 5:17. Just one verse I just want to look at. James 5:17. It says, Elijah was a man just like us. Elijah was a man just like us. Just like us. In the King James Version, it says, a man subject to our passions. In the New American Standard, it said, a man with a nature like ours. In the Amplified, it says, a human being with a nature such as we have, with feelings, affections, and a constitution like ours. That's encouraging to me. So many times I read these things, and it's just a character in the story of the Bible. This guy was a guy just like we, a human being just like us. He had emotions, he had feelings, he had passions. How did he respond when this darkness, he loved the Lord, he saw all this happening. How would he respond? If he's a man just like us, he has an enemy just like us. The devil will tell us that you can't do anything. It's hopeless. You might as well just quit because that's just the way it is. If you ask friends, he had other prophets, but they were hidden in a cave. There's 100 other prophets that were hidden in 2 different caves. Sometimes we're just going to hide from it, pretend that it's not there. Maybe it'll go away on its own. A lot of times that's how I feel. It's like I don't know what to do. But anytime you don't know what to do, the best thing to do is pray. When things seem hopeless, pray. You should pray before that. But man, when things get down to where it's like there's no hope, pray. And that's what Elijah did. He was a man, it says in verse 17, Elijah was a man just like us, but he prayed earnestly, with passion, with vigor, with perseverance, pouring his heart out. He prayed earnestly, not just saying a prayer, but praying earnestly, pouring out his heart to God. How often do we do that? How often do we pour our heart out to God? We have a God that loves and cares for us. How quickly I've prayed for things that broke my heart, and then if I don't get an answer within the first 3 or 4 times I pray, I just move on to something else. I forget. Is our heart broken for what breaks God's heart? And then how do we respond? But he prayed earnestly. He was determined. He was eager. He was zealous. What did he pray? He prayed earnestly that it would not rain. Isn't that kind of a harsh prayer? It's not going to rain on this fertile, lush ground that God has given them. This is the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey, and there's just all this great fruit, and you're going to pray that it's going to dry up? That's kind of a harsh prayer. But hey, a desperate disease calls for desperate measures. You know, if you cut your finger, you can put a Band-Aid on it. It's all you need. You break your arm, you can put it in a cast. But if you have cancer, you have to inject poison into your body. You have to kind of destroy things. Sometimes the best prayer is a prayer not of a blessing as it would appear. You know, I was a prodigal. I ran from God. I'm pretty sure my wife prayed things for me that weren't for my, that I wouldn't find pleasurable. The same thing with my son. I had a son who was a prodigal and running from God. And I was to the point my heart broke for him, but I prayed things that would go wrong in his life. I wanted everything knocked out from under him so he was flat face on the ground and all he had was God. Devastation, pain. I'm paying pain on you because I love you. And that's what he's doing. He's broken for God's glory, and he knows the only remedy is for pain. That's the only thing that's going to turn. I forget who it was, but it's like, not going to quote it because I'll jack it up. But he speaks through pain. He screams through pain. That's how God speaks to us, is through our pain, not our pleasure. We forget about God when everything's great. He gets my attention when stuff starts going wrong. So he prayed that it wouldn't rain. And it didn't rain for 3.5 years. That's insane. That's effectual prayer. That's supernatural prayer. Like, why would you even think that? How would you even think to pray something like that? Effectual prayer is rooted on God's word and for God's glory. We pray in God's word and for his glory. Now, hey, I'm not saying that. Prayer is a mystery. I don't understand how it works, why it works, when it works. I know sometimes I've prayed for people to get healed. They've been healed. Other times I pray for people and they don't get healed. I don't know. The object of my prayer is not for the end result. I don't pray to get results. I pray to be obedient to God because God said pray. Jesus prayed. I don't worry about what happens at the end. I'm going to be obedient and do what God asked me to do. Pray. Jesus had to pray. I need to pray. And just because it doesn't get answered, that's not up to me. That's up to God. But he said to pray, so that's what we do. And most of the time, when you pray according to God's will, there's a lot better chance of it happening. But how do you know God's will? You got to be in God's word. If I pray God's word back to him, I know that that's in his will. And I've seen him answer those prayers, and I've seen him not. I know I'm praying according to God's will when I pray for someone's salvation. I'm praying for people's salvation that haven't come to know the Lord. I know I'm in his will because his will is that none should perish. I don't know why it doesn't work. I don't understand. It's a mystery. Deuteronomy 29:29. What's known to us is for us, but what's a mystery is for God. I don't know. I just know that I need to be obedient. And we're called to prayer. And there's power in prayer. Because if you look up at the verse before, it says, the prayers of a righteous man are powerful and effective. There's power in our prayers. We often forget that. But how would he have known to pray for not to rain for 3.5 years? Let's flip back to Deuteronomy 11. Hang with me. Don't let me lose you in this historical rendezvous we're going through. Now we're going back 600 years prior to the time of King Ahab. and Elijah. We're going back 600 years to when Moses is speaking to the Israelites. They've been set free from Egypt. They're getting ready to go take the promised land. This is Moses talking to them, giving them instructions. I turned to the wrong place. Deuteronomy 11. I'm going to start in verse 10. It says, the land you are entering to take over is not like the land of Egypt. They were captive in Egypt, enslaved in Egypt. They've been set free. They're going to be going into the promised land. It's not like the land that you were kept in Egypt, for which you came. You were where you planted your seed and irrigated it by foot as a vegetable garden. But the land you are crossing the Jordan to take possession of is a land of mountains and valleys that drinks rain from heaven. It's a land the Lord your God cares for. The eyes of the Lord your God are continually on it from the beginning of the year to this end. Remember, this is Moses. This is the land where Ahab has built this thing. He's worshiping Asher. He's worshiping Baal. This is what he's doing in this land. In the land the Lord your God cares for, the eyes of the Lord your God are continually on it from the beginning of the year to the end. So if you faithfully obey the commands I'm giving you today to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, then I will send rain on your land in the season, both autumn and spring rains, so that you may gather in your grain new wine and oil. I will provide grass in the fields for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied. Here's the kicker. Verse 16, be careful, or you will be enticed to turn away and worship other gods and bow down to them. Verse 17, then the Lord's anger will burn against you, and he will shut the heavens so that it will not rain on the ground and will not yield produce, and you will soon perish from the good land the Lord has given you. Fix these words of mine in your hearts and in your minds. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them around your foreheads. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. He knew this. Elijah knew this. Elijah didn't have a Bible, but Elijah knew the word of God because it was taught to him, because obviously his parents taught him, because their parents taught them. We're talking 600 years of a lineage. Who knows what it? Who knows what's going to happen? Who knows what's in your lineage? Who knows when you're passing on the word of God to the next generation, to the next generation, to the next generation? You don't know who it is that you're raising. How important it is that someone knew. 600 years had passed, and exactly what wasn't supposed to be happening is what was happening. And he called him out. That's why he called. That's why he prayed. That's why he prayed that, because he knew that. He was zealous for God. He knew God's word, and he saw the devastation around him, and he remembered what God said. If that happened, this is going to happen. So he prayed it down. Like I said, this is a special anointing on his life. God answered this prayer. Doesn't always work that way, but in this instance, it did. Back to 1 Kings 17. I won't make you turn anymore, if you were turning anyway. Now Elijah the Tishbite from Tishba in Gilead said to Ahab, so he's prayed, he's crying down for not to rain. He's a man just like us. And he says to Ahab, he went and walked right into the king's court. This is just no routine thing. And these times you didn't go and approach the king unless you were invited. If you just walked in on the king, you're putting your head on the line. And you certainly don't walk into the king and bring bad news. That's foolish. You're going to die. It took extreme courage for him to encounter the king and to walk into the king. So he said to Ahab, as the Lord God, the God of Israel, lives. Here he's proclaiming Jehovah. He's the king. He's God. Jehovah God, not Baal, not Asherah. Jehovah God is king of this land. He's proclaiming this to him. And he's not only king of this land, he's alive. The God of Israel that lives. It's like he's not dead. God's not dead. Even though you haven't seen him for a long time, he's not dead. Even though you're worshiping all these other gods and you think they're the ones providing for you, no, it's only by God's grace that you're getting those things. Those idols that you're worshiping have no value. They're dead. It's easy for us to miss this. We don't worship idols like that now. We worship American idols, a lot of different types. Money, material, I don't need to list them. You know what they are. But you know what my idol is most of the time? 99.99% of the time when I'm not worshiping God, I'm worshiping myself. I'm on the throne. I think I provide for me. Look at what I've done. Look at what I've earned. Look at what I'm doing. It's me. Little do I remember that if it wasn't for the Lord God giving me breath in my lungs, I can do nothing. My kidneys are functioning because he gives me eyesight. He gives me strength. He gives me the ability to speak. But how quickly I think it's all me. That's what I worship most of the time. But guess what? It's not me. It's the God that lives. He's the one that allows this to happen. That makes me drop to my knees when I think about that. Puts me where I belong. Lay me down. Yeah, lay me down. As the Lord God, the God of Israel, lives, whom I serve, or in some versions it says, before with whom I stand. It's just like this in his name that I'm approaching you. It's in his power. It's in his authority. It's in his presence. I know he's with me. I'm coming with him. I'm escorting him in here. It's to the God that I prayed and that God answered, that God. That's how I come in here. That's how I have the authority to come in here. But that isn't even the boldest thing. It says, there will be neither dew nor rain. This land is going to, there's not going to be any rain. Like I said before, just this rich, fertile soil is going to become a desert. What boldness. And when God shuts off the heavens, when the rain is shut off, no one can bring it. That's when we come to realize that it's a lot of times at the end of our life, when God's, you know, shutting off the wind and the lungs in our air, or the air in our lungs, we understand that it's him, that only him gives us life. All the things that we chased, we spent all this time chasing after all these things, thinking that it was all about us, and in the end, it's about him. And we come to a realization of who really truly is God, that it wasn't me. And Jeremiah 14:22, he nailed it. And he proclaimed it. He's like, do any of the worthless idols of the nations bring rain? Do the skies themselves send down the showers? No, it is you, O Lord, our God. Therefore, our hope is in you, for you are the one who does all this. When he shuts that off, we realize, hey, it's him. When bringing devastation into my life and pain into my life, he reminds me that it's not me, that it's him I need. Only him. So he's the one that's shutting off the rain. It will not rain. There will be no dew or rain except at my word. Then the boldness and the confidence. Where does Elijah get off saying, only at my word? Not at God, not at Jehovah's word, at my word. Wow. That's arrogant. That's boldness. That's insanity. How can he have such boldness? How could he have such courage? How could he come with such authority? Well, allow me to suggest prayer. Prayer beforehand. Before he ever went to the king, he was praying. Before he ever went to the king, he's praying. He's calling out to God. He's calling out to help. And he's doing it when no one else is watching. He's doing it in secret. The strength that you see publicly came from the stuff that he was doing secretly. We need to pray to the Lord in secret. When you pray, don't pray as the hypocrites do, standing on the street corners out in the front yard so everyone can see me, and their rewards, they've been given their reward. Man sees them. But when you pray, go into your closet, shut the door, and pray in secret to a God that you can't see. And then the God that sees what's done in secret will reward you. That's what he was doing. The power of prayer in secret. The power of having a prayer closet. The power of spending time alone with God. If our prayer time, if our high mark of prayer is at the supper table or at church or at small group or whatever, you need to check yourself. It's easy for me to get up here in front of you guys and I'm going to say a prayer, then try to make it eloquent and sound good and profound. I'm like, I'm some pious guy. It's easy for me to do that because I want you to think well of me. But guess what? When I'm praying in my prayer closet, I'm pouring my true heart out. I don't worry about words. I don't worry about making a show or a presentation. What I'm doing, I'm showing that I'm totally humble and dependent upon him. I don't act it out when I'm in my prayer closet. I'm not worried about what it sounds like or what I look like. When I pray in my prayer closet, it's stuff that's on my heart. It's stuff that really matters. It's not just trying to be religious or do something. It's like, I'm pouring my heart out for this because this is what's on my heart. You don't fake it when you're by yourself. But God sees that and rewards that. There's power in that. So number one is just that he was praying. I think that's how he got his strength. Number two is just the knowledge of God. He knew him. He had a relationship with him. He wasn't just praying to some God that's up in the sky, pie in the sky. He knew Jehovah. He had a relationship with him. Despite the circumstances of what was around him and the world that he saw, it was dark. There was no life for God. It was for 700 years. It was just bad kings. All I see is darkness. And it didn't shake his faith. Why? Because he had a relationship with him. I worship a God. I know God's real. I don't care what the world says. I don't care what media says. I don't care what society says. I don't care what anyone else says. I know God's real because God's radically changed my life. I was a wretched, wretched man, full of addictions, living like hell. My wife, I was going to lose everything that I had. I was going to lose my marriage. I was going to lose my family. I was going to lose all of it. I tried to stop. I couldn't. I could not do it on my own. But through the power of a praying wife, God changed my heart. He changed my desires. He changed the man that I was into something that I never dreamed I could be. I know God's real. When you pray to a God that you know is real, you get power. I don't have to pretend that this is real. I know it's real. It's because it's been proven to me. I can't prove it to you. But I know by my experience, I've experienced too much to ever deny God. I don't care what it looks like out there. Spending time in prayer, believing in the one that you're praying to, and then just knowing that he's with you, that he's a God that's with me. He knew God was going to go with him when he went to the king. I'm going to spend time alone with him because I know that he loves me and I know who he is and I have a relationship and I know when I go, no matter what the circumstances or the situation, no matter what it looks like, I know the power of God is with me. Makes you as bold as a lion. It makes it real. That's how he had the power to do that, I think. From what I can read, the little bit that the scripture gives me, he loved Jesus, or he loved God. He loved Jehovah. And he prayed to him, knowing that he was real, and knew that God was going to be with him. When you know that, you can conquer evil. When you go that, you can tear down strongholds. When my wife and I are united and we're praying for that over our son, their strongholds got taken down. People get set free. Stuff that's impossible without God. It's real, and it's true. He knew it, and so do I. I don't care what the world looks like. And it brings perfect peace despite my circumstances, despite what's going on, despite the chaos, despite the hate, despite the all of it. There's a perfect peace in me. I know God's in control. I can rest in that. I don't depend on anyone else. I don't care what anyone else says. I'm at peace. Verse 2, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah. Notice he didn't have to strive for it. He didn't have to try to figure it out or find it. The word came to him. What's the first thing that comes to me after I go do something? My idea, my thought, what I'm going to do next. Most of the time. But when I'm spending intimate time with God, most of the time I'm asking God. If I'm not hearing it, I'm listening for what it is that God has for me to do next. Most of the time, I'll just do what makes sense to me. If I was Elijah, I went to the king, I had success, then I'm going to go tell the people, hey, you might want to stock up. It's going to dry up. You might want to turn and repent and start worshiping Jehovah. That's what I would have done. Makes sense to me. God said no. Sometimes logic and reason doesn't really matter in divine things. God's asked me to do stuff that's just stupid. If it wasn't, I mean, to man, it was stupid. It was foolish. He asked me to leave a job when I didn't have another one. People were laughing, like, what are you doing? How stupid is that? God told me. That's why. How do I know that God told me? Because, not because it was a direct revelation from here, because I spent time with him in prayer. And I listened to him. And he speaks to you. You have an intimate relationship. It came to him. Intimate time. It wasn't Elijah's thought. It wasn't Elijah's idea what to do next. Verse 3, it says, leave here, turn eastward. You know, He didn't tell him beforehand, go to the king, then after you go to the king, then I'm going to have you go turn east, then I'm going to have you go. He didn't lay this all out for him. He told him, go to the king and tell him it's not going to rain. And then once he did that, then the word came to him and said, all right, now turn eastward. We'd like to know what's going on. We want to see the whole thing, the whole picture. God leads us step by step. When God gives you an order, God tells you to do something, just do it. Don't worry about what's next. I always want to, well, what do you want me to do after that? If I do that, then this is going to happen. Don't worry about what's going to happen. Do what it is that he's told you to do, what he's laid on your heart to do. He's a lamp to my feet. His word is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. It isn't a spotlight miles ahead. The path that he leads us on is a path of faith. And contrary to the path of faith is sight and independence. He doesn't want me to depend on me, and he doesn't want me to depend on my circumstances and what's around me. It's a life of faith. It's Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 was the first verse I ever memorized as a believer. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he'll direct your path. It might not be the path you want to go. It might not be the path that makes sense, but he's directing it. He's leading it. He knows what's best for us. He knew what was best for Elijah. Leave here, turn eastward, and then verse 3 it says, and then hide in the Kerith Ravine. You know, to hide. I looked up that word, hide. It's to absence yourself, to remove yourself. Why would he need to hide? Well, if you look in chapter 18, verse 4, it says Jezebel was killing the Lord's prophets. His life was on the line. He went in front of the king. They probably didn't like it too well. But he did something that, you know, he's getting moved. Why is he getting moved? For protection. Sometimes when we're obedient, 99% of the time when you're obedient and do what God's asked you to do, there's going to be opposition that comes with it. It's not going to be just this glorious thing. You do what he says, there's going to be people that are going to persecute. You try to live a holy life, you will be persecuted. There's going to be people that are going to be against you. There's going to be movements that are going to be against you, and you stand up for God, or when you do the right thing, or when you follow him. God is faithful in protecting us. Sometimes we do the right thing, and then it seems like there's a turn for the worse, and I'm over here all by myself. Like, what, did I do something wrong? No, he's protecting you. If you've been obedient, and you feel like he hasn't honored you, and you feel like you're just over here by yourself, don't become discouraged. Recognize that it's him protecting you. That he's with you, that he cares for you. Easy to forget, easy to become discouraged, and the enemy will tell you that. See, you shouldn't have done that. Look at where you're at now. You're down here in the ravine, in the depths, in the valley, spiritually. And also, I just think it was, you know, allow me to suggest the separation. He wanted him to hide himself because he wanted him to be separate from what was going on in the kingdom. It was just nothing but filth. You know, we're to be in the world, but not of it. It's just, you can't marinate in the world. You can't just hang out in the world all the time. It's just like a chicken breast. You put it in that marinade, in that bag, and you expect it not to soak up what's in it? That doesn't make sense. You got to get out of there. You can get dipped real quick. And that's what he did. God dipped him real quick, but man, you can't stay in that. We're a product of our environment. If you want to see who you are, look at the five people you hang around with the most amount of time. That's who you are. Be careful who you hang with. Be careful hanging out in the world and in worldly places, thinking that you're going to lift somebody up. It's a lot easier to bring someone down than to lift somebody up. He's protecting them. Makes me think of James 1:27, which is often quoted about widows and orphans, but the end part of it I rarely hear. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and then this, and to keep oneself from being polluted from the world. We need to be isolated from the evils of the world, or we're going to become polluted by them. Ephesians 5:11, that's coming up. Tony will be probably getting there in 2019. Ephesians 5:11. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. That's what Elijah did. He lived that out. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. He didn't hang out in there. It's like, you do it, call it out, and then get out. And that's our calling too. But I saw it. I'm like, man, don't do it like Elijah unless God really speaks to you. I mean, you don't call someone out on their sin unless you're in a really tight relationship with them. You've developed, you know one another, you love one another, and then you call them out maybe. But we don't go around calling out people in the world on their sin. We're a lighthouse. We shine light. Just like Tony has been saying, we create a contrast, not conflict. We don't go and create conflict. We just shine a light. And then there's the rocks and the bad things that are exposed that can take someone down are exposed by our light. Allow God to do the work. But we're called to shine. And then also, just what was going on there, and if you go to Ephesians 6, it talks about resisting evil and about fighting and putting on the full armor of God. But there's three things in the scriptures that we're to flee from. We're not to fight. We're not to resist. We're to flee from them. Sexual immorality, idolatry, and the evil desires of our youth. Those things we're supposed to run from. You don't try to fight it. You don't try to resist it. So I think God was encouraging them to flee from that. That's what was going on. Idolatry, sexual immorality. Run from it. Flee from it. Don't try to resist it. He tells us that for a reason. Sin's fun for a season, but it ends in death. Verse 4, you will drink by the brook. Turn eastward. Turn eastward, hide in the Kerith Ravine, and you will drink by the brook. Notice it's a brook, not a river. It's a brook, not a river. Another way of God, like, I'm going to give you just enough, but I want you to trust in me. I don't want you trusting in a raging river. I'm going to give you a little trickle down through there, and you're going to have to trust in me that I'm going to provide for you the water that you need. The brook isn't going to provide it. God is. God's given him the brook, but it's don't trust in the brook. Don't trust in the vessel. Makes me think of Proverbs 38 and 9. It's like, give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor your name. Don't give me, I mean, that's a big disadvantage living in America. Like, who needs God? I go to work, I get a paycheck, I come home. If it's too hot, I make it cold. If it's too cold, I make it hot. I open up my pants. When's the last time someone here prayed for their daily bread? Seriously. I could go for days and days and days. Real easy for me to forget about God. The abundance that we have makes me think of me again. Oh, look at this good job I had. I got this nice house. I got a car. I can go anywhere I want. I got lights. I got everything. Who needs God? Only when pain comes in my life am I reminded of that. Devastation. But he gives them a brook. He's our provider, not my job, not my effort. God provides. He's instilling that in Elijah. He needs to instill that in us and remind us of that. Then verse 4 continues, and I have ordered the ravens to feed you there. The ravens. This is an expression of just the sovereignty of God and the supremacy of him, the sovereignty that he would choose a raven. Why would he pick a raven? A raven is a nasty, dirty, filthy bird that they weren't allowed to eat. A raven is known for not even feeding its own young. It eats dead carcasses, and that's what's going to be bringing me the food. It's kind of just like what you guys just walked into. You came in here expecting to get served by a nice little dove. You got a raven. It's like, who is this guy, and why is he going to be bringing? I really don't want to have eat after that. But that's how God is. It shows, exhibits the power of God. And it's not in the raven, and it's not in the dove, and it's not in the brook. It's God. God speaks. He uses the silly things, the least likely thing that he would use. And then just his supremacy in that he can make it happen. Not only did he ordain it to happen, he made it happen. He can make a raven fly there. That's and deliver the food for him. Meat and bread every day, morning and night. That's incredible. Only God can do that. Only God can ordain that. A lot of people can say it, but to make it happen. The power of him. And this is a true story. This is real. I've ordered the ravens to feed you there. And also, I'm just thinking, just like another form of his protection. He has birds flying in his food. If he had man bringing him food, or if he had a dog or another animal, ground animal, people might see the path where it's continually gone morning and night in this ritual, and they would find him, expose him. With a bird flying over there, you're not going to notice. You're tracking flight patterns of ravens? No. Bird flying over, whatever. Just another form of his protection, his provision. I've ordered you the ravens to feed you there. Where am I at? Verse 5. So he told him what, so he did what he told him. So he did what he told him. Does it make sense? Did he say, hey God, how about you send me over here instead of over here? That doesn't sound like a really great plan. I really don't think I want to do that. Did he delay and say, oh, I don't think I really heard from him clearly, I better pray about it? No, he did it. He was obedient. And there's humility in obedience. A lot of times, the Lord's laying something on my heart, and I think that my plan is a little bit better than his. I think this would probably work better. And I go run off and do that. And it ends in an epic fail. And pain in my life, pain in other people's life, and no glory for God. But obedient and trusting in him, being humble. And you know, most of us don't want to be alone. Most of us don't want to go to the ravine. We want to be around people. We want to be around activity. When he takes you alone, then you got to deal with your stuff. We've always got stuff going on. We can't stand to be quiet. You got to have the radio on, the TV on, something to distract us so we don't have to process the things of our life. We need alone time with him to get intimate with him, to hear from him. My flesh screams. The world shouts. God whispers. I got to get alone. I got to get away from the world. I got to get put myself to death and humble myself and go spend time alone. And also that he, you know, Elijah's living it out. He preached obedience. He preached honoring God, and he did it. He lived it out. He practiced what he preaches. Man, is that a thing that's needed in this day and age. That convicting to me. I can stand up and do this, and then in a moment I pull out here into traffic, and I'm acting like an idiot. How quickly the power of God in me and the flesh rises up. To be obedient, to be submissive to the Spirit. So he did what the Lord told him. He went to the Kerith Ravine east of the Jordan, and he stayed there. He stayed there. Notice the verse before that. You will drink from the brook that I have ordered you and the ravens, and they will feed you there. There. Where is it that God has you? Where is your there? There. There is where the provision is going to be made. You might not want to go to the ravine. You might not want to be by yourself. But there is where it's going to be fed. That's where you're going to get your nourishment. That's where you're going to be provided for. That's where you're going to be protected. That's where God's presence is going to be. Right there. There. Where is there? It's real easy to just get a little bit of dry season where you're just getting a little bit of dew, not getting rain. The fruit's getting smaller, whether it be in your ministry, whether it be in your marriage, whether it be in your job, where things start looking a little greener over there. I think there's a better deal over there. He's looking a little better. She's looking a little better. This looks like a little better opportunity. I want to run over there. That's not where the provision is. That's not where God's called you. That's not where God's called me. Here. This is where I'm supposed to be. You know how many times I've wanted to run from here? When things don't go my way, and Tony frustrates me. Wouldn't allow me to lead men's group, and I had to go through that whole process of him breaking me and humbling me. I was ready to just run away, but I knew that I couldn't, because if I ran away, I wouldn't be where God wanted me to be. He has me here for a reason. Even though it might be painful, even though it might be difficult, even though the marriage might be struggling, even though it seems like it's hopeless, I'm certainly glad that I stayed there. I'm certainly glad my wife stayed there in our marriage. It wasn't easy, it wasn't fun, and it wasn't very fruitful for a long time. But she stayed there, and I stayed there. And now I got 31 years of marriage to celebrate that I never would have had somewhere else. I have more joy in my marriage now than I've ever had. It was very dry. Didn't look good. Didn't think it was going to happen. Thought it was hopeless. The power of prayer. And we stayed there. Same with a job or a ministry. It doesn't seem like it's fruitful. Doesn't seem like it's productive. And that job over there pays a lot more. And it's got all these other benefits. Well, has God told you, called you there? The world might be calling you there. Your flesh might be calling you there. But that's not where God's going to provide you. But if you're there where he called you, you will be provided for. You will be protected. You will be nursed. But if you turn your back like the prodigal and you run to a foreign, far-off land, you're sure to be in want. It'll last for a while. That other guy or girl you run off to, it'll be fun for a while, but believe me, it's going to run out. You run off to your other job, if God's not in that, believe me, it might not end up being all that it promised to be. But guess what? God's faithful. You turn back, you run back to him, just like the prodigal. You turn and come back to him, he's more than willing to accept you back. He's always more than willing to forgive you than you are to repent. When I make a stupid choice, I'm always resistant because I think God is like I am, that he is slow to forgive. He loves you regardless of what it is that you've done. You don't have to earn his love. He's waiting on you to come back. Band, you can get in place if you want. Really, where we need to remain, there, I mean, there's a lot of different places that he's called all of us as individuals, where you're there is not my there. But I think there is one spot that there is for all of us, and that's the one we really need to think of. And that there is at the foot of the cross. He's called us to the foot of the cross. And guess what? Everything that we need is there. All of God's protection is there. All of God's blessings, there. All of God's provision, there. All of God's grace, mercy, there. At the foot of the cross. We don't do any of this on our own. We don't earn this. We can't work it up. We can't do it without him. We need to remember what it is that he's done for us. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. But he died for every one of us, and he loves us. So I just want to encourage you to get to know God. Spend time with him. Develop a relationship with him. Cry out for all the heartache, all the burdens, all the struggles, all the anxiety, all the fears. Get in your prayer closet. Throw it out to him. Develop that relationship. Foster that relationship. He'll teach you that I'm going to be with you. I'm never going to forsake you. You're going to see answers to prayer. Things are going to change. It's a season we're in. If it's difficult. If it's good, it's a season. But always spending time with him, getting in his word, developing that relationship, then shining your light, exposing evil around you, encouraging people behind a lighthouse. People are attracted to light. If you're burning on fire for Jesus, you don't have to advertise a fire. People are attracted to it. Burning for him. No matter what your circumstance, no matter where you're at, always remember that Jesus loves you. And he wants you at the foot of the cross. Lay me down. I'm not my own. But man, the provision, the protection, the joy that comes from being down there. Father, I just thank you for your word, Lord. I just thank you for Elijah and the story, Lord, and just your faithfulness, God. Your sovereignty, your provision, how you protected him. And that it's still true thousands of years later. And so applicable, Lord. God, I just pray that this seed, this word, Lord, has just fallen on the hearts of these people, Lord, and that they would just be encouraged, strengthened, edified, built up. Lord, that you would just create in them a heart for prayer and a love for your word, Lord, that they wouldn't trust in themselves. They wouldn't trust in the things of this world, Lord, that they wouldn't be fearful of all that's going on around us, but they would just be trusting and secure in your loving arms, Lord. At the foot of the cross. Lord, call the prodigals back to you. Lord, comfort those that are hurting. Lord, just minister to us. Just so that we can become more like your son and just closer to you for all your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
rise from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the high.
Thank you for your presence. Father, I thank you for your people, Lord. I just want to pray a blessing over them as they leave, Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. God bless you all. If anyone is needing prayer, please feel free to come up and see me. God bless. Have a good day.